I was shooting video one day at the annual Antique Airplane Association flying in Blakesburg when I spied in the distance what looked to me like an airplane wearing a tuxedo. It gleamed in the sky with its beautiful shiny black and white paint scheme accented with gold pinstripes. I waited for it to land and went right over to meet the pilot and find out more about this elegant looking flying machine. It was Jerry May and his son Mike who had just flown in from Nebraska. Well, here, I'll let Jerry tell you a little bit more about his 1937 Rearwin Sportster. Thank you.
My name is Jerry May. I live in Kearney, Nebraska. Today I want to tell you a little about my Rearwin Sportster. I purchased this in 1954, and because it had been actually it had taken apart on some of the pieces, and so it needed to be rebuilt. I brought it back to Kearney. A little history on this. In Hastings, Nebraska was where this airplane came from the factory, and it was there until 1945. Later on, it was sold then to a man in Kearney, Nebraska, which was a good friend of the family, and he had it until 1954. And so I bought the aircraft and rebuilt the airplane, and or wanted to rebuild the airplane. Ended up that military service got in the way, and college and a few things. But I finished it in 1964, and we flew that then for quite a little time. And of course, a grade A fabric, as you well know, it deteriorates in a period of time. So later on, I tore the airplane down. Other projects got in the way as far as our business, and so I was unable to do it right at that time. So I decided then, it's been long enough, it's been tore down, so we really kind of hot rotted to get it finished. And so we did this with Seconite fabric, and went through the engine, done the necessary work for it, and finished the aircraft. And of course, we came up with this black and white finish, and it seems to be an attractive finish that people seem to enjoy. So it has an 85 horse LeBlanc engine, and the five cylinder, and it came with the aircraft. It is the original engine, so it's not been changed or whatever. As we did the woodwork, I rebuilt the wings. Of course, they had many of the ribs were the place it was sagged and not up to we call airworthy conditions. So what we normally did, I decided every rib would be the thing to rebuild. So I went ahead and built all new ribs for the wings and ailerons. The spars were in great shape, and so cleaned those and inspected them to find out if there was any flaws, and they were in great good order, so we used them. Rebuilt the wings, and the turtle back and the fuselage also is a wood construction, has plywood bulkheads and has stringer strips that go from the back of the cabin to the front of the tail section. So rebuilt that, made it new, and one of the baggage compartments was that in that unit too. So this aircraft has a lot of neat things for its time and its age. It was built in August of 1936, and then of course came to Nebraska. And one of some things that we found as we were rebuilding it, that little things that normally doesn't end up on other aircraft. The seats are welded into the structure. There are eight tubes that actually weld to the structure and to the seat. So security is very high on that area, and of course that's one safety factor too. We went ahead and besides using the fabric on the aircraft, we put in new windows and just really went through and overhauled everything in the tail wheel, the main landing gears, the brakes, the hydro part of the gear, we rebuilt that. Everything has been new from front to back. And a few issues we found as we were rebuilding this last time. In the wing ribs themselves, we found that they were on the top of the rib, it was getting flat between the risers, which let the wing have a weird shape or not a, a shape that would be conserved over the rib. So what we basically did, by getting approval from FAA, I added three vertical members in the front part of the rib in order to keep the curvature over the top of the behind the leading edge. So this is the first part of the rib, as it is the spar area is carrying through to these here. Then behind, what they had done, they used a crisscross design, and with that, leaving a large gap in there for the top of the rib, and this is where they were getting flat. And so by adding one vertical with the gussets proper and the rib, this gave it a lot of stiffness and with very, very little weight added. And we did that on each of the ribs, only took care of the first three areas. After that, the rib was fine. And this really keeps the shape of the wing, and it'll never settle over a period of time with the dope pulling on the fabric. And it's one added advantage to that is it should last for many, many years and still be serviceable. The rest of this aircraft is original. It has the original Bendix type brakes that they came from the factory with. The hydraulic landing gear is still the original, and we just went through and serviced it and filled and that type of thing. Otherwise, the aircraft has just never been damaged in its lifetime. Everything was straight, the cowlings, everything, and so we just used the parts that was available at the time. As far as the flying characteristics of this aircraft, it's kind of surprising. It's a little and a lot like a Super Cub. At sea level, they claim that the takeoff range is very short, and we find in this country, it does great here also. Very easy to fly, it's very ductile. Stalling characteristics are very, very low. You can just really put it in positions where you never think to be where you should with that type of airplane. But it's like a Super Cub, it hangs on and does a great job. With this hydro gear, you can land on a very rough area and it just seems like it just takes care of all the vibrations and does a great job. On cross country, it cruises at 105 miles an hour. It's very comfortable and it's within the area of a 150 Cessna, Luscombs, that type of aircraft, and very ductile. And of course you land in just about any area if you really had to as a forced landings. I might mention a couple of other items on this aircraft that just to show what the engineering capabilities were back in the 1930s. This is a different type of airspeed. When these come down with the twin lines, instead of having just two lines sticking out here to show you that one is pressure and one is static, they run it through, and this has this ring on the airspeed itself that you can move this back or forward to change the airspeed reading, and of course this way you can set that to your aircraft so you can match it up, and it makes it really a wise unit. Another thing here, which generally in like in a Cub or this type of thing, we find out that they just leave the bolt in the open. Here we have these very nice containers that you slip down over the thing and hides the bolt that holds the jury strut to the strut. It's really a neat little item. Too bad we don't think of some of them yet today. So. Another advantage to this aircraft, with these cuffs that we have on front and rear strut, this streamlines it to the wing, and so it has actually less drag and increases your airspeed on your aircraft a little that way, and they thought of a lot of things in 1936. We decided that when we wanted to more or less dress the airplane up, these wheel pants did not come with the airplane originally, but they're the same style, and also the company who made the wheel pants for the Rearwin back then actually made these types. These were J5 Cub wheel pants also. So they were fit the tires and done a great job there. They're aluminum and light, but they do get dents. And being on a wheel and over a tire, we figured we wanted to solve that problem. So we used this like either Rhino liner, that type of thing you use in a truck box. We had the man spray in a coat in these. Weight was not a great big thing, and of course it really stiffened them up. They do not get dents in them now. The washers that we have here on this wheel pant, as we also have on the cowlings, that was made by my son. He machined them and engraved them so that we have the name of the company on there. It helps protect the wheel pant and the cowlings from chafing in the holes because they cover more area, and they've worked out really well. Another great advantage to this aircraft is the landing gears themselves. This is an oleo hydro type. It has springs upper and lower, and it actually is filled with fluid. So as the plunger works, this gear is very soft for very rough fields, and it just floats over the ground. It just it really takes a lot of the really hard bumps, and you do not notice them in the flight in the cockpit itself. It's a great advantage and really advanced for its time, because not until much later have we seen this type of thing being used on other aircraft, such as like a Ronca Champs and some of those. Maintenance is very low, because actually now and then you check this at like at an annual time or this type of thing, and there's no really maintenance to it. The springs are strong and they're under compression at times, and so they work quite nicely. Another big advantage to this fairings here on the landing gear themselves, this fairs in the gear, streamlining it. It works in action on the top end. It's such little movement below that they don't have to worry about the structure in this area. So they come in and fair it in, which closes it up and really makes a great advantage for the drag in this area. One thing I would like to show you on this aft area of the aircraft, they were using very neat cowlings on here to fair it in so it looks like it's really not a lot of drag to it, and it really helps out. This actually is the fitting that goes to the rudder and down, or fin down to the elevators. We actually chromed these two units here. Flying wires are stainless steel, polished, and so same on the lower end. We decided this would make it, give it a lot of tension and no corrosion, no rusting and that type of thing. It has a control system here for trimming the aircraft. It uses a trim screw. It has cable going to the front end so you can actually crank it and get either and raise the elevator or lower the front of the elevator. And it's a very trim, very good system, and it's advanced because many of them did not have it in this time. Another thing that I put this on the aircraft because this came originally in exactly the same location, exactly the shape of the letters and size and that. I copied off the original fabric so I knew. I thought that would be an advantage to put it on here so people knew at least what the aircraft was. And I think it helped the looks a little too, so. Originally, this aircraft came with a tail skid, and due to the concrete runways and bleached blacktop that we've had in the past, they finally we decided to install this tail wheel, which is a full swivel, steerable Scott tail wheel. The one that was on there, as a, being just a normal tail wheel that they had put on, was just wore out, and so this is a much better one. It's easier to turn with it. It's easier, it's much better in landings, and also a lot easier on the ground when you're putting it in the hangar and that type, because it will have a full swivel tail wheel. We did have it chromed, and so cannot rust and that type of thing. The pads locations on top of the rudder and the end of the wings were actually original with the factory. We finally did find these lights that would fit on here, the right style and this type of at a time and an age. And so we did go ahead and had those chromed, and we installed the system that way. So this is an advantage too. So to show you another difference in this aircraft to some of the earlier versions, our elevators here are in a one-piece configuration with the pitch horn up and lower. And on this elevator pitch horns, they go to two cables which go up to the stick. The earlier versions on the elevators themselves, they had them separated. And of course, then they placed a horn out here on the elevator, one up and one lower. It went cable over the top, cable on the bottom going up, which joins together, then goes up to the stick as one cable. The problem is, this is a lot of drag out here in the air. They came up with a great idea of putting it inside this way. It says you come up, you can see the horn through the fitting hole here that is hidden and well protected that direction, and the cables go then forward up to the stick. And it really makes a neat using unit to have. And it's very durable with the two being together, much better than being separated. And so that's what I have on this. The cables went forward and came up into this area on the earlier 1936s, one on the bottom. These are all inside, which is a great advantage to it. Another advantage to this aircraft is the type of step that it has here. When a Cub has a type where it comes down, back, and up, as you're getting in the aircraft and your foot is in the hole, it's hard to get your foot turned when you get into the front cockpit especially. This one is fairly easy. We'll open the door here. You can see how your foot applies right in your area here. You can grab the tube here, and you can throw yourself up in the front cockpit or in the rear, whichever you like, and it's not a problem at all. I might show you a little of the hardware on this thing that we did use. This is the original door handle. The only difference is we chromed it so it would look nicer. The original catch is also on this with the one that is on the strut. And the advantage to this is that this works really well. It holds the doors firmly, and you can then get access to the cockpit and have no problems at all. As I mentioned before about the step, I'll kind of show you how it makes it a little easier to get into this time an airplane. So you grab this tube up here. You're able to bring your leg up around, throw it around the corner, and you're in. So that makes it a lot better. And we find that in this area, you'll find this has a lot of headroom in this thing. The man who originally actually put it, Mr. Rearwin, he said that he was a tall man and he wanted something that somebody could get in and operate out of. And so it gives you a lot of room. It also is a pretty easy aircraft for front or back. It doesn't seem to matter which it is. On the sides, your throttle is over here in location, front and back seat. Fuel shutoff is here, and your trimming mechanism is over here on the side. Other controls are for your carburetor is on this side, located very handily. And then, of course, we have the instrument panel. These are all the original instruments redone. When we redone the aircraft, we went and had them overhauled. This is your mag switch over here on the side. Oil pressure for the engine. This is the RPM that you have. This is the airspeed, of course, of the aircraft, and it goes in increments around. This is the cylinder head temperature, oil temperature for your engine itself. And this is the zenith height meter. Very few was used in aircraft, and this happens to be one of the aircraft that did have it in. This is the original too there. It's a non-sensitive altimeter. This is the rudder pedal on the sides, which give you ample room. We have the kick pads so that you, of course, do not wear out your floorboards, that type. Brakes are back and to the middle here. You can come back and get on the brake itself, and which is very seldom needed anyway in this aircraft. And the stick, of course, is just like any the other type of aircraft. They're long and the movement is not much. This is all the movement you have for the ailerons, so it doesn't bang your legs on either side of the aircraft, but yet gives you the control that you need on the wings themselves. One thing that we did modify, which is not original to the aircraft, we've incorporated this stainless steel strip over the door edge because it keeps the fabric from being chewed up and worn as you're getting in and kicking it with your feet. And this is a great improvement on this, and so we were adding that for that reason. Above on each side of the cockpit, on this board that we put across here, I wanted to put the Rearwin Sportster name on though, and I thought it would dress it up a little. The hole in the unit itself is where you read the gas gauge in the wing itself so that you can tell what you have for fuel aboard. Just one more additional one. The one in the back at the cockpit, behind the cockpit, is a also the logo. I put it on the baggage door, and it helped the people realize what it really is, and so we thought that was a good idea. I wanted also to show you these fuel caps that we have manufactured for this aircraft. The old kite cap was a form cap that had just a hole for venting, and this would allow water to get in the tanks. Didn't like that. So my son machined these caps. We installed a tube in here to give it forced air into the system. As far as our antennas, that's of course a mandatory thing now that you have to have in this day and age. They are not original, of course, to the aircraft, but something that was needed. Also, this we call the greenhouse. It's actually a tinted polyester glass, and this is to keep so the sun has a little bit of buffering before it gets in the cockpit, keeps it runs a little cooler. And that was original to the aircraft. It went that far back, and that was what had that. So we also did the same with the windshields. And this windshield is made in three pieces. In later times, and probably in 37 and that, 38, they did go to a formed glass to fit in this. But this is actually the original style and the frame that was used in this day. These wingtip lights, they were original equipment in their time, and we found these, chromed these as we did for the rudder, or for the fin, and so we used them, and they work out really nice for this arrangement. Actually, the plate was welded on the tip bow when they were made. They just never had installed lights on this given aircraft, so we did it on ours. One thing a little different with this aircraft, it has a different dihedral than most of them. This had very flat wings, and very little dihedral, 5/8 of an inch is all it has. It seems to be really stable in the air, and in rough weather, it seems that it's maybe better than some of them that have dihedral. We're not really sure, but it's one thing that they did incorporate back in that time in 1936. This is our power plant for this aircraft. The spinner we're using on the prop here is not original equipment. We just thought that with the hub standing out, this would be something to really decorate it and give it a little bit less drag too, so we installed this. This prop I ordered 1979. Didn't get the airplane finished as soon as I had planned, so it was longer, and we put it in 2007. And we had this one made at Senchenik, so they did a nice job. The man, when he called, I asked him if he could make a prop for it, and he said, "What's it for?" And I told him for a Rearwin, 85 horse. He said, "I know just what you want," and he sent the prop to me, and so it's done a good job. This engine is a LeBlanc radial. It has 5 cylinders, and of course it has twin ignition to the cylinder, so you aren't only just depending on one magneto. If one quits, you just still have a chance to keep flying. Actually, it's an 85 horsepower, and it produces at about 2150 RPM. Not a fast engine, but it has good power. The carburetor hangs down below, and a carburetor scoop on here, which when you close the door and open the door, you have carburetor heat, which is necessary in icing conditions or the wrong conditions, and this will help keep it running this way. One thing about this engine is a little disadvantage in one way. In these rocker box covers, which are hidden up here underneath the top of the cylinder, the valves are non-lubricated from the crankcase like most engines are today. So we have to grease these every 20 hours, and then the grease takes care of the being able to let the valves work in the guides and that type of thing. Later on they did come out with the pressure lubricated engine, but this is before that time. Has the oil tank is in the back. It's separated. The oil pump pumps it to the engine, and then it's returned back to the tank itself. The exhaust stacks on the back of this engine were actually rusted so badly we couldn't use them when we were done. So we built our own exhaust stacks. They're oval shaped, which is like the original ones. We copied off the original as close as we can with the injection coming out the back of the thing underneath the cowlings. And so after we got these completed, sent them down and had them plated so that they have a more fire resistant and then have a tendency to rust that way. So they work out pretty well. There are 2 stacked. One handles the top cylinder, the cylinder on this side, and the cylinder on the bottom. The other exhaust stack handles only the other 2 cylinders. Another things that we have changed, this originally did not have shielded ignition. They were the old style spark plugs. And of course, when you're using radio and this type of thing, you get this big static in your radio itself. So we installed these kind of plugs and also shielded ignition coming back to the magneto itself, and that dampens that out. As far as the engine goes, we do not need a battery of any type. We hand crank this engine, and also it does not need electricity for the magnetos. They generate their own current, so everything's taken care of in that area. This engine it's a fairly smooth engine. It has more vibration than a Pose type that we have in later versions of aircraft, but one thing about it, it's not as rough as some of the radials were back in their days. They had refined a lot of things and changed some things that really helped out. So the cowlings around the engine, and this which go around and go between the cylinders, are all original cowlings. Has an opening in this area right in here, which has a data plate for the engine, tells you the information about the engine, which is handy to have. The cowling is to keep the air flowing around it so it's smoother and you don't have the drag of the aircraft. Plus, it can actually keep it going through the fins to help cool it too. The outside speed ring is another thing, not only for just looks, it's actually for helping keep the air a little tighter in around the cylinder heads and so they do cool better. Normally, they have a lot of tendency to be noisy and get a lot of other things. What we came up with is we did for the wheel pants, we put this truck bed lining material in here, which is like Rhino line or some of those different different kind of units, but it cools or keeps this thing a little stiffer, doesn't get dents in it, and also it has this is oil and gas resistant, so it doesn't affect it any, and it's a little easier to keep clean that way too. So evidently when they were changing around to the 85 and horsepower one, that type of thing, they use some of the older technology, like the crankshaft only has a two-bearing crankshaft, where the later ones were three-bearing. So we don't know if we have the only one, but this only has a two-bearing crankshaft in this given engine. And otherwise, that's about it. And as far as the amount of them, there are six registered with the Department of Aeronautics. And I'm not sure if there's some out there maybe are not registered, but this is the only six of the 85 horse Rearwin Sportsters that there is. So that's about all I can tell you about it. It's just that we enjoy the aircraft and it's fun to have. About the first time that I can remember about flying was when I was about 2 to 3 months old. My father, of course, had learned to fly earlier, and so it was kind of a family thing even at that time. And he learned to fly in 1926, I think he told me he had 3.5 hours of dual, and at 5 hours, he was hauling rides, and when he had 7 hours, he was given dual. So his flying time was pretty short, but yet he had a lot of experience that way. So I'm sure I enjoyed it, and then later on, from about 6 months on, I really got the kick of it then. So I started off flying a biplane that was made in Lincoln, Aero Sport. He said that the glide angle was like a barn door. Whenever you close the throttle, you better be ready to land, because that's it. And so then later he had J2 Cubs, he had a Swallow with an OX5 engine in it. Had like a 40 horse Cub, 65 horse Cubs, that's basically what he'd flown. He had chances to fly a Ford Tri-Motor one time and monocoupes and different aircraft of that nature. Remarkable thing is that Dad was pretty fortunate. He got to meet one of the Wright brothers, and he asked him if he would, and he signed his pilot's license just for the fun of it. So he was pretty happy about that. Well, aviation's, I think, special to a lot of people. It's just the thrill of just, I guess, getting off the ground and being able to control the aircraft and have a safe flight. And you can go distances. It's a fast way to travel if you have an occasion for that. And it's just fun, and fun getting together with others and conversing on what you normally do and what you like to do. And it's just a fun game. We have a business where we are APs, IA, and mechanics, and we enjoy working on all types of aircraft, really, and helicopters. And we like to rebuild. We generally have probably average one every year to 2 years, and so we've done quite a number. I've built four different aircraft from scratch and in the home-built experimental category. And let's say six helicopters too. So that's kind of a fun time. I just like to design and build, and that's where we're at. We build a different kind of a helicopter. It's called an air jet driven. We pump air through the blades, comes out a nozzle at the tip end, and this way you do not create any torque to the fuselage. So you don't really need a tail rotor or gearboxes or transmissions or any of these expensive items that wear out. And so we think it's a good, safe way to fly, and it's also an easier aircraft to fly too. Really, as far as the difference between building and flying, I like both really well. It's just a lot of fun, and I enjoy getting into an aircraft that's either been a crack up or just needs to be rebuilt, and building it from scratch. And then of course I always like the idea that I get to do the pilot to test fly them too. So then I give them back to the customer and make him a happy man that way. Well, I think everybody enjoys having an antique airplane, or at least have been around people who have. I enjoy working on them. Other aircraft also, we don't really care. It's fun for us whatever we do, you know. So as far as one wanting to get into aviation, I've had other people come and ask about what should I do. The thing is that in this day and age, costs money to do this, but if you really have the desire, you shop around and find a good instructor and a good place to at least rent an airplane, or if you're that enticed and really getting into it and you know you're going to love it, then you can buy an aircraft. One is an older airplane, but yet in good shape, and start flying. And I guess if you want to start, be sure you finish, because that's the most important thing. And you know, and I think then when you learn to fly, you'll turn around and you'll go to these fly-ins and like AAA or Oshkosh or whatever, and you see these airplanes, think, gee, I'd like to have one of those. And I said, pretty soon the spark is there and you'll soon be involved, and then there's no end to it then. The reason I got the Rearwin is that I really enjoyed the airplane just looking at it. I thought it had a lot of history behind it, and I thought this would really be something to have. And so as far as a special one, there are so many of them that you'd love to have, but you can only got to cut your supply down to something you can afford and do. And of course, then I not only was in fixed wing and did this type of thing, then I kind of switched over. I joined the EAA, and that is the Experimental Aircraft Association. We started a chapter, and in this chapter we had people that wanted to build and do but didn't know how. And so as being the counselor of our EAA chapter that way, I sat down and we even designed a glider, built that, flew it. And then I, of course, look at their work, you know, and make suggestions, and that helps them to get along and get their projects getting them completed. And so we've had a lot of fun doing that. And then, of course, I just, the other aircraft, I've done so many different things with them, modified, changed, paint jobs, just about everything comes along.